Welcome to another Beers with Engineers. My name is Zach Renkert. BroadSky is joining us today. So let's do some quick intros and let's know what you guys are drinking today.
Okay, awesome. My name's Tom Benson. I'm the VP of Strategic Partners here at BroadSky Networks. What am I drinking? This is a Castle Cream Ale from Castle Danger on the North Shore. I am proud to call Minnesota my home, born and raised. So if you're in Minnesota, the Upper Midwest, Castle Danger, check them out.
Hey, everybody. Beau Barker. I am the Vice President of Technology at BroadSky. And today I am drinking the Deschutes Brewery IPA. This one's called Royal Fresh.
And you know me, I'm Zach Renker. Unfortunately, I haven't had a chance to resupply my beers, so I had to go with my emergency rations, which is Ham's Cream and Lager, which we all know comes from the land of Sky Blue Waters. It's a nice, smooth lager that does the body right.
Another Minnesota beer. God, are you guys old enough to remember the commercials from the 70s?
Oh, yeah.
I certainly not.
Yeah. With the bear? Zach, you're probably not. 70s, man.
All right, well, enough about beer. Let's discuss industry trends. So, I mean, you guys are really big in the wireless space. I mean, 5G's been on the tip of everyone's tongue for a long time. Lots of hype. There's some deployments in the field. I know Verizon has some presence in Chicago. What's your take on it?
Absolutely, Zach. There is some disjointedness to the 5G spectrum. You know, I guess the first part of it is the whole millimeter wave and then mid-band spectrum, where that's being deployed are different areas. So the carriers are calling everything that they're deploying on a 5G core as 5G, and that mid-band spectrum isn't the 5G we've been promised necessarily. And then, you know, there's some, I guess, speculation or disagreement from the carriers on, you know, will they use DSS? Will they not use DSS? How are they going to dynamically allocate spectrum? Those kind of things. So it's still kind of up in the air.
Here's what's odd about 5G. 5G used to be defined as millimeter wave. So back when it was on everyone's drawing board, 5G equaled millimeter wave. And millimeter wave is nothing more than how tall the wavelength is that's going to be broadcast from the tower. And that would allow you to process downloads from 1 to 3 gig, which is incredibly fast. So this year we got to the point where, well, we want to actually call it 5G, but millimeter wave still isn't widely deployed. And so the goalpost shifted. And now they're talking about combining different frequencies together and making that 5G. But if I want to translate that into right now and what's interesting, then what I would translate it into is what we really think about 5G is equal speed. 5G equals faster speed. And if you want faster speed, you can get that today. That's sort of the message that we've been putting out at BroadSky. Zach, you and I and Beau are all sitting in your conference room. Pre-COVID, back in the good old days when you could travel, and it was 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and we brought out a router that's called a Category 18 router. And a Category 18 router bonds four separate frequencies from the carrier together, bonds it all into one usable download channel, and generates higher speed. So we came to test it, the router plunked down in the middle of the conference desk, and we put in an AT&T SIM card, and then we had a Verizon SIM card in the back, and then we had a T-Mobile SIM card in reserve. And we ran three separate speed tests at 4 o'clock in the afternoon with that highway right outside TDI's offices in Chicago. I don't know the name of the highway, but that highway was stacked with cars. It was just, they weren't moving and everyone was on their phone, obviously. And yet we still pulled three separate speed tests. I think we pulled arbitrary, you know, circa 107, 105, and 112 meg download when the cell towers were really getting utilized. And that's with commercially available technology that's here today. We'll be ready for 5G, whatever flavor the carriers call it. We'll be ready to access it immediately. If we want to get a millimeter wave signal in, and we have to do some special things to grab that signal outside the building and bring it inside the building, we can do that. But never mind 5G and what may be the hype curve. If a company wants to go 100 meg plus on a cellular network, we can do that today.
So with the rise of remote work, have you seen an uptick in demand for the Cat 18 appliances? Because I don't think I could get away with working on a hotspot on my phone if my network's
right.
Getting hammered by my kids or something like that.
You are. Here's the breakpoint we see, frankly. Companies can't afford to enable all of their at-home workers with a dedicated circuit for everybody. They just can't. Some workers are going to end up working on their home network and do the best they can. The people who really bring in dollars and have to have an uninterrupted bandwidth at all times. So I'm thinking about their creatives, their advertising people who are moving big files, their financial analysts, anybody following stock prices who has to be on at all times. Anybody who's doing any sort of video production, or at-home podcasts or at-home training or anything where their Zoom is open at all times and they have to have sort of dedicated bandwidth to make sure that they can get that out uninterrupted and they can't retake, those are the people who are bringing in dedicated bandwidth. And the concept is pretty simple. You just bring in a router from BroadSky, you drop it on the employee's desk, you give them a password, they're the only ones who can access it, right? So the whole family's not jumping on it, just the at-home worker. And they have their own bandwidth to run themselves all day long. If you dedicate it to a high-value employee, you can do this for between $100 and $200 per month per employee at home. So it's reasonable for a certain segment.
I think now's a good time for a break. I mean, this is Beers with Engineers after all, so.
Crack. Top up.
Nice.
Nice. Great pour. Nice frothy head.
Fantastic pour.
So I mean, we've spoken a lot about fast speeds and 5G and how they're all making their way into the channel. I, TDI and BroadSky have already had a lot of success with customers. Can you think of one off the top of your head?
Yeah, there was a bank that came to us through you guys, and they don't allow their name to be stated because banks are very secretive. But this would, and this one example would serve for many examples, actually. But in this particular example, they were ripping out their MPLS network, and they were moving to a different MPLS network, a different provider through a TBI sales partner, sort of a classic thing. And what they wanted to add 4G backup to every location. And so we literally started from the sales partner had never heard of us. And TBI connected us to them, and we went through the sales process against every competitor that existed in the world. It needed to satisfy the following requirements. One, it needed to work. But two, it also needed to satisfy all banking audits. If you're a publicly traded bank like they are, you get audited by the federal government, and then you get audited by the SEC to make sure that you don't have holes in your, that no one can attack your network and get into see banking information. It's probably the most scrutinized, regulated data transfer that exists in America today. They deployed at the time 205 or 210 locations, and we got them out the door in about 3 months. The second thing that happened is they acquired another bank of circa 50 branches a year and a half later, and they immediately added all 50 of those locations to their core deployment. So clearly, they were satisfied with the service they got on the first 200. They bought 50 more locations. They deployed it for all 50 of those. And about a year and a half or 2 years later, separated by a year, but they had branches in Florida and they had branches in Houston. And we look at data usage every month. And each bank would send a nominal amount of data because it's just backup. But we noticed in 1 month that three of their Florida locations, all of a sudden their usage just spiked. It went through the roof. We put a report out showing anomalous usage. And so we emailed it to them, and then I followed up with them and said, you know, why is this usage so high? That bank is flooded in Florida. And then a year later, it was the same story. That bank in Houston is surrounded by 3 feet of water, but we're still open. And we have to be open by regulation. If we can't service a customer, if a customer can't walk in and withdraw money from their account during normal business hours 2 days in a row, we have to close the bank branch. And then we are out of compliance with our federal banking charter. So we have to give customers access to their money at all times. And we're running our entire bank on you. And that persisted for about a month in both locations. We kept their doors open and we processed every transaction that bank did over real, a 25 or 30 day period in both cases.
Even up to Fortune 50 companies, we're proving out that wireless is the secure connection. And not only can they rely on it for that connectivity piece, but as far as, you know, FINRA and HIPAA and PCI and all those compliance vectors that they have to deal with as part of their business, it works. And when I say wireless, I do mean LTE wireless, not Wi-Fi. Big differences there in security.
So why is it LTE wireless? I mean, why has it gotten such a bad rap?
You know what, Zach? It's funny because we've come full circle on this. If you think about 3G and when you got your first data phone, and you could punch up a stock quote and you could see a few things, but then somewhere in 2012 or 13, they started touting the 4G networks. The ad I specifically remember was, I think it was an AT&T ad, but the ad was in 2012 or 2013, the mom goes to the dance recital and grandma can't be there. And the mom holds up the phone and granddaughter's playing Tinkerbell and she jumps around and grandma's staring at her computer and it's like, oh, except it just flat didn't work. You could not do that in 12, 13. You just couldn't. They hyped 4G for two straight years about what's going to happen before it actually happened. Now, in 2020, we call that FaceTime, or we call that Periscope. Works like a charm. right? You can do that all day long, but it was promised in 2013. And the reason I do the full circle thingy is because here we are now touting 5G. The promise of 5G, unlimited download speeds, blazing fast, cut the wire, won't cost you a dime. We're in the front end of that hype cycle, no different than 2012 or 13. And everything that's being promised on 5G is going to happen. It's not going to happen in Q1 2021. BroadSky is working really hard to separate fact from fiction. We're really hoping to avoid the disappointment curve versus the promise curve this time around. And so a customer wants 5G. I think what they really want is speed. They want how fast can I go? That's a question we can answer.
I think too, about that same time period was when VoIP really started to get pushed out to businesses, and 3G just didn't support VoIP. And that's
absolutely
probably where most of the stigma came from, that put a stink on LTE for sure.
Right. To be clear, VoIP over BroadSky LTE works flawlessly.
It does.
And I can attest to that as well. I mean, we have BroadSky SIM cards in our lab. We have plenty of VoIP phones running off of them. So no noticeable issues whatsoever. So I can absolutely attest to that. Well, thanks for joining us on this episode of Beers with Engineers. Once again, I'm Zach Renkert.
Beau Barker.
Tom Benson with BroadSky. Drink Minnesota beers.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers, everyone.